Thank you so much for watching WTV Sports Center. I do hope that you're enjoying your Saturday afternoon. Today we have a great show lined up for you. We are going to tell you what's happening in the world of rugby and basketball. And of course, later in the show, Collins Ogutu joins me to discuss matters football. We are looking at what is ailing Chelsea Football Club, a club that is struggling at position 16 in English Premier League table. So he's going to tell us more about that. And in the second part, I'm going to take you to Sagana Rapid Falls, where we had the African Canoeing Championship taking place last weekend. And we look at what is ailing the Kenyan team, because despite the fact that Kenya has the best grounds or the best waters for canoeing, the team is still struggling there to make it to the finals. WTV Sports Center starts now. Always a pleasure being your host. My name is Elijah Mwangi. Welcome to the program. We start with matters rugby. Now the Kenya Sevens team is currently in South Africa and they are playing Madagascar, Senegal and Mauritius in the Pool A encounter of the 12-team tournament that is currently underway. And this is the Olympics 2016 qualifiers. Let's have that story. In South Africa, Kenya was seeking to put away a dismal performance in the previous season of the IRB circuit as they fought for a place in the Rio Olympics to be held in 2016. Household names such as Collins Injera and Dennis Ombachi led the Kenyan outfit in what appeared as a relatively easy Pool A, where they were facing Madagascar, Senegal and Mauritius. The winners of the 12-team tournament will book a place at the Rio Olympics, while second, third and fourth placed teams will compete for a final place at the Olympics next year, June. The team is perceived to be in high spirits after a week-long of high-altitude training camp held at Nandi Golf Club, despite going to the qualifiers without any contracts. Moving on to matters basketball, now the 2014-2015 NBA season champions, that is the Golden State Warriors, have started their season on a very high note, and this is after registering a 9-game winning streak. Stephen Curry, this is the most valuable player last season, is currently the league's top scorer with an average of 35.8 points.
After a sterling performance last season in the NBA, the Golden State Warriors are eyeing a second title this season if their start to the campaign is anything to go by. A 100-84 win against the Memphis Grizzlies took their win tally to 9 games out of 9, making them the only team in the NBA this season with a 100% record. Last year's finalists in the playoffs, Cleveland Cavaliers, lead the Eastern Conference, winning all 7 games and losing only but one. The team led by LeBron James has shown intent of topping their conference standings by once again being a force to reckon with. Meanwhile, Kobe Bryant's season is at an all-time low, with the Los Angeles Lakers winning only one game this season and losing 7. This is a welcome contrary to what Kobe would have hoped for after missing out on a large part of the Lakers' season last year due to a knee and shoulder injury.
He finished the game with 20, Golden State's lead at 4.
And now let's talk about football. Chelsea has been struggling in the English Premier League because currently it stands at position 16. There have been calls to have Jose Mourinho, that is the head coach, fired. But Abramovich, who is the owner of the club, says that he's there to stay. Let's have a look at what is making news in the English Premier League. It has become so hard to pinpoint the root of Chelsea's current problems in so many areas that the club under scrutiny for underperforming. A 1-0 defeat at Stoke left the Blues just 3 points above the Premier League relegation zone after the opening 12 games of the season. A 2-1 win over Dynamo Kyiv in the Champions League last week was supposed to be the turning point in their campaign, but once again it proved to be a false dawn in a season that has seen a catastrophic start to the defence of their title. At both ends of the pitch, Chelsea are struggling. Their three strikers, that is Diego Costa, Falcao and Loic Remy, have bagged just 3 league goals between them this season. Under fire Chelsea boss Jose Mourinho has been accused of losing his grip and delivering a pathetic performance on TV by mirror writer Andy Dunn. He's accused Mourinho of irrelevant and meaningless excuses for Chelsea's wretched start to the season and suggests the Portuguese gaffer deserves to be held to higher standards than other managers. Chelsea is struggling at position 16 in the English Premier League table, and that's where we start our conversation from. I'm joined by Collins Ogutu, a writer with Sportica.com. And remember, you can always join us online and on air. On Twitter, it's at C-Ogutu.
C-K-Ogutu.
At it's Elijah Mwangiet. It's WTVK. Use the hashtag SportsCenter. Let's keep this conversation alive. Collins, good to see you.
Good to see you.
How was your week?
Good.
Now, I'm tempted to ask you concerning the latest that we have in the world of sports. And this is about the training of Harambee Stars.
Yeah.
You know, from Monday, Bob Williamson had started complaining that I cannot find my team on the ground. What's your reaction concerning that story?
My reaction is as usual. The house is not in order, obviously. So, you know, when, for a player to come from Norway to Kenya, if I'm a player, I don't have to use my money. Because I'm coming to play for the nation, right? Mm. So Kenya must take me back to Kenya. And if FKF does not do that, how do you expect me to come back to Kenya? So I think that's what is happening. The organization is not very correct. Some players don't have that good money enough to carry them from those places to here. And of course, if you use your money to this place, no one compensates you. So it's like you say, okay, you're saying, I better stay back in the club I am.
Now, let's go to the English Premier League. And in fact, the story that you've just run was about Chelsea performance. Now, something is not well with Chelsea Football Club. What do you think is ailing the team?
Everything is not correct. At Chelsea, everything is not correct. I have a lot of things to say about Chelsea. Not because I hate it. I like it. That's why I tell them the truth.
It's okay, it's
right now, they sit position 16. When the season started, no one knew that Chelsea would be position 16 today, right? You didn't know that, and no one predicted that. Pundits didn't say that. So I think players, no, a number of players have ganged against Jose Mourinho, and they're compromising the future of Mourinho at Chelsea, despite the fact that Abramovich has said Mourinho is staying. So there are two things likely to happen here, Elijah. One, it's either Mourinho to stay or go, or some players should be axed, and a lot of players.
Some players should be axed and maybe told to leave the team. I know maybe you could specifically be talking about the likes of Hazards and all that. And you know, it all started, remember, starting this season with Caneiro and, you know, scandals. What's not working between the coach and the players?
The relationship is bleak. Some players, I think four or five, decided that this is not the right man for us. We cannot work with his philosophies. The moment players have decided doing that in the dressing room, then obviously something has to go wrong. So Hazard, Diego Costa, Fabregas must be sold. They must be released under every circumstance. I know Chelsea fans will say I'm being too much on them, but that's a fact. You either sell them or sell Mourinho. So if they do that, I think the team will start having some what you call stability, and then they need to focus much on the January transfer window. They bring in new blood. Then there is a mistake that Mourinho did, and I think will haunt him for life. Selling Cech to Arsenal, that was the worst mistake he ever did. So when Courtois is injured, then you have Begovic. Begovic is a goalkeeper with whom or to whom every shot is a goal, all right? And it's really putting Chelsea at a spotlight. Everybody has now known that any ball kicked toward Chelsea's goal is a goal.
You're really talking of how good Cech is.
Yeah.
I don't dispute that. But let's just go to the last performance. You know, Arsenal playing Bayern. What went wrong then?
That's Bayern Munich.
So what?
That's Bayern Munich. Any defender in the world cannot stop Bayern from scoring. All right.
So some of those blame goals, the defenders or Cech in this case?
I praise Cech. Cech is good, by the way. I think he's one of the topmost goalkeepers celebrated in Europe right now. The fact that he conceded five goals in Allianz Arena is not a shock to me, because that was expected, all right? I think sometimes we might also talk about the defenders, the Parmatasaka and Koscielny and the back four. Sometimes they let in a lot of goals. You know, some shots you can't blame a goalkeeper. because they're goal bound. The goalkeeper has nothing absolutely to do. But Czech also made a lot of saves. Remember, those goals would have been 6 or 7, yeah?
6 or 7, in a way, yes. None is better. None is a lesser evil. But let's look at that was the other week.
Yeah.
Then there was Arsenal playing Tottenham last weekend.
They drew
1-1. Do you really think that Czech really did well, or were the defenders just, you know, on point?
Czech did well. The rest of the Arsenal players did nothing. All right? From my point of view, I expected an Arsenal win. Because from the previous record we have in the North London derbies, Arsenal has a good record against Tottenham, whether White Hart Lane or in every stadium. But this one, I think they relaxed. They were like, okay, we don't want that pressure of being top of the table. Because remember, Man City had drawn with Aston Villa. Mm. And it therefore worked to the advantage of Man City, because Arsenal refused blatantly to go top of the table. So I appreciate Czech, but the rest of the players, at least they did some few mistakes.
It's okay. Let's leave Czech matters alone and focus on the coaches now. There has been a lot of talk that, you know, Pep Guardiola, you know, Simeone from Atletico might be the next coach for Chelsea. If anything was to happen with Jose Mourinho, whom do you think may come and take his place?
Diego Simeone. I would propose Diego Simeone. And I prefer him to, who else have you mentioned? Guardiola. Guardiola is getting tired. Eh? I think his tactics are becoming too much known.
The man that you're saying is getting tired is the man who thrashed Arsenal.
That is Bundesliga. Bundesliga. How many times have Bayern defended that trophy? That tells you the quality of that league, right? Bayern are not all that superior. We know that.
But let's look at the record of Pep versus that of the Atletico's Simeone. I think Pep, you know, is a force to reckon with. Remember, even when he was in Barcelona, Barcelona was, you know, the best team in the world, so to speak.
But there comes a time when change is paramount. We cannot keep on appreciating Pep for things he did in the past. Remember, we need a coach would grow with the team, right? It's like you're telling us to take Ancelotti, for that matter. Because, of course, they have good record. They
yeah,
have
and
good
in fact, track record. Ancelotti is also being mentioned.
Yeah, but for me, I would prefer Diego Simeone to all those other people you're mentioning.
Let's look at someone else, you know, that left Manchester United, went to Real Sociedad, and over the week, he was shown the door.
Yeah.
That is Moyes.
I pity him. The worst mistake he did was to leave Everton. I think the rest of the things will follow him until he will decide one day to go back to Goodison Park. Moyes' sack at Real Sociedad tells us of how poor he has become. If you can't, you know, if you can't manage a team like Real Sociedad in the Primera Liga, I mean, then what can you do? Yeah. So I heard that he's almost coming back to the Premier League to manage some team. Was it Newcastle or Sunderland, something like that? I'm sure if he comes back to the Premier League, he'll be fired as well, because he has lost ground. That's what's happening.
So looking at the table now, after this, you know, this international break, any changes that we should expect?
After the international break, we should expect changes. I don't expect any change at Chelsea. The only change I expect at Chelsea will be in January, when they let go Hazard and company and bring in new players who are focused enough to join the leagues of Kudzuma, Matic and the rest, to take that team to where it belongs. You know, it's at a place where it does not really belong. So, at the top of the table, Manchester United are struggling. They are struggling, by the way, that's a fact. They're having 2 shots on target in 90 minutes.
Let's just jump in and ask you concerning Crystal Palace, now that you've talked of Manchester United. Yeah. Crystal Palace is a small team in courts. Of course, you say there's no small team in EPL. Yeah. But of late, we've really seen it dominate. You remember, it was playing Liverpool.
Yeah.
It won. Manchester United, that was a draw. Mm. What is Crystal Palace?
It's Alan Pardew. It's Alan Pardew. The tricks of Alan Pardew are smart. And I think he's one of the best coaches we have in the Barclays Premier League. So he has built Crystal Palace from scratch. Mm. You remember they fired that other coach and then they took Pardew. So Pardew has brought in changes. And Crystal Palace are indeed a great club that will give challenges to a lot of clubs, including Man City, by the way. They have not played. No, they have played. Mm. City won narrowly 1-0. So that tells you the quality of Crystal Palace. We have to look forward to them.
Now, as we wind up, let's look at Chelsea position 16. If that has to change, what must happen and how far do you think, in terms of climbing the table, Chelsea will go maybe in the next three or so matches?
They play Norwich in the next EPL match. If Chelsea fails to win against Norwich at Stamford Bridge, I will never talk about Chelsea in this show. So I expect them to win. Then from there, we expect them to be at position around 14 or 13, depending on the results of the other teams. And then from there, we expect the momentum to continue. But it also depends on who are they meeting. So after Norwich, where else do they go to? If they go to Old Trafford or somewhere else, we know what is likely to happen because Hazard, Fabregas and Costa have refused to play.
So some football analysts have really argued that, in fact, Mourinho is now not concentrating so much with the English Premier, but Champions League, he's the man to watch. Do you agree with that?
Who says that? Man to watch in terms of what?
He has all the time and all the energy to concentrate now for Champions League.
Okay, I respect the observations of analysts because people respect mine as well. I have not been convinced that Mourinho is the man to watch in the Champions League because remember the group he is in. He recently won narrowly against Dynamo Kyiv at Stamford Bridge. That was a hard-fought win. So that therefore puts the Mourinho you're talking about to spotlight. Whether he will be a man to watch this season's Champions League remains to be seen, but the quality of players we have at Chelsea right now are people that can be beaten by any other team, including Dynamo Kyiv. So I don't think they will. They will.
We are talking about the performance of Chelsea, a team that is currently at position 16 in the English Premier League. There has been a lot of talk in terms of who is to change the standings, and Jose Mourinho, who has been under pressure, seems to be there to stay. That's according to Abramovich, the owner of Chelsea Football Club. And you can always tell us what you think. Collins here, I think that the deal is as good as done and Chelsea doesn't have a chance. But you can have your say as well. SMS line is 20058. On Twitter is a WTVK using the hashtag SportsCenter. Almost now winding up the show, but not without talking about rugby. Now, Kenyan team, currently in South Africa. And generally, we are looking at 2016 Rio Olympics. What do you think the state or the stake of the Kenyan sevens team, Shuja?
I'm really optimistic with that team. I was reading something about them the other day and I realized that the squad, we have a depth of squad, The players you see right there, the likes of Injera, the likes of Mbaka and Andrew Monde are back into the team, right? So definitely with Ayimba sure of his job. Remember there had been allegations whether he'd be fired or not. Right now I'm sure he's very sure of his job. And I also hope Kenya Airways is also giving them some money. So whether they not or not, I think
we can only hope.
Yeah, we can only hope they do, but I think I'm very optimistic this team will reach far.
Now, last weekend, by the way, Collins, I was in Sagan, and in fact, we are going to run that story thereafter concerning canoeing. But even before we watch the story, what's your general assessment concerning canoeing in Kenya?
It's a sport that I have never written about. Sorry to my fans, I have never. The reason why I've never is that no one takes it so serious. So if I am a sports writer and I don't take it so serious, it means I should be faulted, right? So after your report, after your feature, I think I'm going to take it so seriously. And I think Kenyans need to take it seriously.
Hold it there. Now we come to the end of our show. But stay tuned to WTV because after the break, we'll be taking you to Sagana. Last weekend, we had the 5th African Canoeing Championship taking place at Rapid Falls in the Sagana River. And you'll be shocked, despite the fact that Kenya has the best waters for canoeing, the Kenyan team is still struggling to make it to the finals. Next, we are going to tell you of the challenges, or rather the struggles, that our Kenyan team is facing. Stay tuned to WTV. That story is next.